Well, good morning, everyone. Thank you for your patience. I want to welcome a few of the folks who walked in with me, along with saying hello to all of you. I want to acknowledge President Charles Dean Connor. He is president of the American Lung Association. Thank you for joining us. Dr. Truitt is here, and we're going to hear from him in just a minute, so we'll save his introduction for then. And Dr. Burton, who you'll hear from as well. I also want to thank Ms. Perry, the music teacher from Amadon Bowen Elementary School, who brought us some very special guests from her second grade. How are you guys? Yeah? It's kind of hard to sit still, but this is a little bit better than class for a few minutes, right? Because you're here for a little bit of history. I want to thank you all for joining us here today. I'm really glad to be here with all of you. I have to take a moment and look around at this room. This room is full, but it's full of a diverse group of people from different interests. We have environmentalists who we work with often and who I hope are here often helping us to understand environmental issues we face. But we have public health advocates, as you'll hear of in just a few minutes. We have businesses represented. I think we have labor here. I know they RSVP'd. We have religious leaders here, as I see one of my dear friends over in the corner. Such a grouping, such a cross-section, and we also have folks listening by phone. Today we're taking an important step forward in EPA's efforts to safeguard the health of millions of Americans. I'm very proud to announce that EPA is proposing the first ever national mercury and air toxic standards for power plants. Under the Clean Air Act, these proposed standards will require American power plants to put in place proven and widely available pollution technology to control and cut harmful emissions of mercury, arsenic, chromium, nickel, and acid gases. The suite of air toxics covered in the mercury and air toxic standards are pollutants linked to neurological problems, developmental disorders in our children, respiratory illnesses, and other debilitating, costly, and often fatal health challenges. By proposing these standards, we are initiating an effort that, through the common sense goal of reducing harmful pollution in the air we breathe, will save lives, prevent illnesses, and promote vital economic opportunities in communities across the country. We are confident in these expectations because this has been the history of the Clean Air Act for 40 years now. Most importantly, the Clean Air Act is literally a lifesaver. It prevents thousands of premature deaths each year, 160,000 of them in 2010 alone. Along with lives saved, the Clean Air Act has reduced asthma attacks, heart disease, and numerous other health conditions that burden American children and families. Last year, it helped prevent more than 170,000 trips to the hospital. We also know that protections in the Clean Air Act have brought trillions of dollars in benefits to our nation, not only by avoiding medical bills, but by keeping our kids in schools, our workers on the job, increasing productivity and economic potential. They have also helped create jobs. As of 2008, the environmental technology industry, which develops, manufactures, and sells the tools that help keep our air clean, supported more than 1.7 million American jobs. The innovation and use of cleaner products like catalytic converters and smokestack scrubbers has led to job growth in the installation, maintenance, and operation of pollution control technology. These are good, labor-intensive jobs that cannot be shipped overseas. Finally, the simple fact of being able to breathe cleaner has made and will make a countless difference, a remarkable difference for countless Americans. That includes me and my family. My youngest son has battled asthma his whole life. He spent his very first Christmas in the hospital struggling, literally struggling, to breathe. Without the Clean Air Act protecting the air around our home, around his school, around our church, and the places we have traveled, there is no telling how much more challenging his condition could have been. Like any parent of a child with asthma, I can tell you that the benefits of the Clean Air Act, And protections like the ones we are proposing today are not just statistics, they're not abstract concepts. This law has changed millions of lives for the better and is a banner example of public policy that serves the people of our nation. The mercury and air standards, toxic standards being proposed today are designed to build on the successes of the Clean Air Act. As I said, we are proposing the first ever national standards for reducing mercury and these other toxics from power plants. There are currently no national standards limiting these emissions from America's power plants, which are the source of half of the mercury emissions, half of the acid gases, and 25% of all toxic metal pollution in our air. Like our other Clean Air Act protections, the mercury and air toxic standards are expected to provide broad benefits. First and foremost, there'll be the benefits to our health. Widespread adoption of pollution control technology will prevent an estimated 17,000 premature deaths and 11,000 heart attacks, while also preventing 120,000 cases of childhood asthma symptoms and ensuring about 11,000 fewer cases of acute bronchitis among our children. As you can see, this is especially good news for the young people with us today. These are the second graders who came here from Ammon and Bowden Elementary School in Southwest Washington, D.C. Welcome to EPA. By reducing pollutants like mercury, we will reduce threats to your healthy development. We'll also help lower exposure to toxins that could put them and millions of American children at risk for neurological damage and other health challenges. There'll also be broad benefits for American workers. As we've seen with our other health and environmental safeguards throughout our history, the implementation of the mercury and air toxic standards is expected to open opportunities for American workers. It will increase demand for pollution control technology and open opportunities for the workers tasked with installing, operating, and maintaining that technology. We're estimating that these first ever standards will support 31,000 short-term construction jobs and 9,000 long-term utility jobs. The proposal and implementation of these standards will also have benefits for American utilities. For the first time in 20 years, they will have certainty about the standards they must meet. And setting national standards for mercury and air toxics will level the competitive playing field and close loopholes for big polluters. Utilities that have already put in pollution control technology will no longer have to compete with those who've delayed their investments, a group that includes almost half of the nation's coal-fired power plants, which lack advanced pollution control equipment. In fact, facilities that have already taken responsible steps to reduce the release of toxins into our air will be at a competitive advantage over their heavy polluting counterparts. And to ensure cost effectiveness, we have proposed flexibility in meeting the standards. The technologies being required already exist in abundance, and under the proposal, power providers have 4 years to comply. Let me close by saying that the success of this effort is underwritten by the broad coalition of advocates and stakeholders that support it. We have the support of environmentalists and health protection advocates like President Connor and the people at the American Lung Association, which has been fighting for clean air for more than 100 years. Thank you, sir. Alongside them are members of the utility industry who have been waiting 2 decades for this certainty and are ready to get moving on multi-pollutant planning, energy efficiency, and clean tech investments. We also have the support of American workers, the women and men who will be put to work building, installing, maintaining, and operating pollution controls. Finally, we are counting on the input of the American people. This proposal is followed by a public comment period. As we saw with our recent Clean Air Initiative to cut emissions from industrial boilers, the public comment process can improve the cost effectiveness of a rule without compromising health protections, which are required under the Clean Air Act and expected by the public. Today's announcement is 20 years in the making, and it is a milestone in the Clean Air Act's already unprecedented record of defending the health of American families. With the help of existing technologies, we will be able to take reasonable steps to protect our children and our loved ones and prevent premature deaths, heart attack, and asthma cases. We look forward to getting to work. Thank you very much. Now I'd like to introduce the President of the American Lung Association, President Charles Dean Conner.
Thank you very much, Administrator Jackson. Good morning, distinguished guests, and I'm especially honored to have the privilege to speak to our most distinguished guest here today, you second graders. Well, thank you for coming. Kids, today is about you and millions of other children across the country and the opportunity for all of you to grow up healthier and stronger. Today is about fulfilling a promise that the nation made to all of us. As a matter of fact, this 20-year-old promise was made more than 12 years before our special guests here were even born. It's a simple promise, but it's proven very hard to achieve. It's the promise of air that is clean and healthy to breathe. As the president of the American Lung Association, I'm honored to be here today as Administrator Jackson announces EPA's plan to clean up the nation's biggest industrial source of toxic air pollution, coal-fired electric power plants. Our nation has waited a long time for this day. When it becomes final, the standards for cleanup that the EPA is putting forward today will save lives, protect the health of millions of Americans, and finally bring about an action that is 20 years overdue. This must happen. We will make sure that this promise is kept. Last week, the American Lung Association released a report entitled Toxic Air, the Case for Cleaning Up Coal-Fired Power Plants. Our report took a hard look at the 84 different toxic substances that these coal-fired power plants emit and their impact on the air we breathe. What our report found isn't pretty. Coal-fired power plants emit 386,000 tons of hazardous air pollutants each year. These pollutants include things that we learned a long time ago are not good for us or our children. Such things like mercury, arsenic, chromium, lead, hydrogen fluoride, and dioxins. Very few of us can avoid these dangerous pollutants because over 444 coal-burning power plants operate in 46 states around the country. Emissions from these plants can travel hundreds of miles from their smokestacks. Unfortunately, the heaviest burden falls on those who live closest to the plants. Too often, those are the people who are least able to bear them. These are the people Congress and administrations of both parties have promised to protect. Breathing these toxins is hazardous to our health. Some of these hazardous pollutants cause cancer, some cause birth defects, and harm children's brain development. Some cause asthma attacks, heart attacks, and strokes. Some of these toxic substances kill people. After the plants install the needed equipment no later than 2016, some 17,000 lives will be saved each year. That bears repeating. 17,000 lives will be saved each year. That's why this is so important and why we cannot afford any more delays. Equipment that can save those lives is already in place in many plants. It is now past time for all of the plants to meet the same standards. It is simple fairness. All must play by the same rules. While this plan will deliver better health and longer life to the American public, it also delivers the regulatory certainty that the energy industry has asked for. This proposal spells out what targets must be met and when. The technology is already being used by some plants today. Plant owners have flexibility under the law to select an appropriate combination of controls that will give greater protection to both human health and the environment. The Lung Association's message to the nation's electric power companies is start now. Begin to put these tools in place as other plants have done. Don't wait. Start now to save lives tomorrow. I can assure you that no one will complain if the air gets cleaner faster, and many, including the American Lung Association, will thank you. As I mentioned, we've been waiting for this a long time. In 1990, a bipartisan Congress amended the Clean Air Act to provide that protection to the public from these hazardous air pollutants. Some coal-burning power plants, power companies, and of course their lawyers and lobbyists, have used every trick in the book to delay complying for all these 20 years. It is now time to close the two-decade-old loophole that has allowed coal-fired power plants to avoid having to clean up like all other industries. While we applaud today's proposal, the real challenge is to get it done and start saving lives. We know today's proposal is the start of a public process. One of the great strengths of the Living and Robust Clean Air Act is that everyone has the opportunity, as the administrator says, to provide feedback and comments on a proposal. The American Lung Association will carefully analyze this proposal, Madam Administrator. We will look for ways to improve and strengthen the proposal and provide you with our expert advice on the questions you ask. We will recommend that all oil and coal-fired power plants install modern pollution control equipment. This will reduce hazardous air pollution by the maximum amount possible, and we recommend that they start now to meet the requirements of the law. Only with such measures can we protect human health, including our children and our elders and the people who suffer from lung disease. The American public has waited long enough. In November, we look forward to the final rule that will at last put these life-saving protections in place. We are counting on EPA and the power industry to put these standards in place to protect all Americans, and especially you kids, from the health risks imposed by these dangerous pollutants once and for all. It is now my great pleasure to introduce an esteemed pediatrician, Associate Dean at the University of South Carolina School of Medicine, and President of the American Academy of Pediatrics, Dr. Marion Burton. Dr. Burton.
Thank you, Administrator Jackson and Mr. Connor and my other colleagues in the room, but especially to my young friends to the left. I think you already know that this rule is about you, and it's for you and all the children in America who will follow you. And we're most proud that we've been able to get this far with this accomplishment, and we're most appreciative to the EPA and the administrator for helping move this along. The American Academy of Pediatrics is proud to stand with the Environmental Protection Agency, the American Lung Association, and other numerous organizations in support of cleaning up the air that we breathe. Dirty air makes children sick. That's the long and short of it. If you think it's an expensive process to put a scrubber onto a smokestack, you should see how much it costs over a lifetime to treat a child with a preventable birth defect. In 2005, the American Academy of Pediatrics and other health organizations joined the environmental community in suing the EPA over proposed rules that would have delayed by 10 to 15 years meaningful reductions in emissions from coal and oil-fired power plants. In particular, the AAP was concerned about the health consequences for children of failing to strictly limit mercury emissions from power plants. For over 200 years, mercury has been recognized as a very potent neurotoxin, that is, of the brain. The brain of the developing child is uniquely sensitive to methylmercury, and fetal exposure to methylmercury can cause devastating birth defects, including brain damage and progressive deafness and blindness. The AAP and its partners won that lawsuit in early 2008 when the courts ruled that the EPA's proposed rule violated the Clean Air Act. And while we were vindicated by that outcome, we were very concerned about how long it would take the EPA to draw up new and more protective proposals to replace the one that had been struck down. That's why I'm especially pleased to be here today with Administrator Jackson and my physician colleagues and Mr. Connor at the unveiling of this new rule. We appreciate the EPA has not dragged its feet on drafting this law. Maximum Achievable Control Technology Rule. That's the name that we will follow, I guess. The rule announced here today places common sense limits on the toxins released into the air by our nation's power plants. This new rule will lead to cleaner air for communities all across the United States. And unlike the previous proposal, it will not allow for the creation of so-called hot spots of pollution, where children and families are exposed to higher levels of mercury and other toxins simply because they live near a power plant. The new rule will require all power plants to reduce their toxic emissions, and it doesn't let some plants off the hook. And it will reduce not only mercury emissions, but lead, arsenic, acid gases, and other pollutants as well. We will undoubtedly hear that this rule is expensive, and it will cost money, but not acting is even more costly, not only in terms of jobs, health care, and education, but in human suffering and quality of life. This is a matter of making choices and setting priorities. If we fail to invest in preventing pollution, we'll accept the cost of living with and treating preventable birth defects and disability among our nation's children and their families. Administrator Jackson, the American Academy of Pediatrics commends you for the EPA's work on this critically important rule. Once in place, this rule will lead to cleaner air and better health for millions of American children and their families. The AAP looks forward to this new rule being finalized and implemented as quickly as possible. And now it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Jonathan Truitt, who is representing the American Thoracic Society. Dr. Truitt is a critical care physician at the UVA hospitals, and he is literally a counterpart of mine as Associate Dean for Clinical Affairs at his institution as well. Dr. Truitt.
Mr. Jackson, distinguished guests, and members of the EPA, imagine yourself with asthma. You might have trouble breathing every day, but today is a high pollution count day, and your breathing is much more difficult. You can't get air out, and it's causing you to trap more air in, so your chest gets as big as the Michelin Man. Now, you can't get air in or out. You'll take your inhalers, but if they don't work, you'll become desperate for air, and you'll be on your way to the emergency department. And in the ER, you might get admitted, and you might get a breathing tube in your windpipe. And then you may see a doctor like me, a lung doctor. We will work to get you off the breathing machine, and we will work to get you home again. But you'll be in the hospital and the ICU for several days. I'm Jonathan Truitt, and I treat patients with lung disease at the University of Virginia. I'm a professor of medicine in pulmonary and critical care at UVA. We know air pollution is bad for your lungs. Years of research and thousands of studies have made it clear that patients get sick from air pollution. And those with chronic illnesses, such as asthma, get even sicker, and it can kill them. When I see lung patients in the ICU, they're gasping for air. Every effort they make, they're worried could be their last. As a lung and critical care doctor, I might be the last stop. After failing to improve at home, patients, when they come to the ED, are treated by ED nurses and physicians. But if they don't get better, they might get a tube in their airway and come to me and the nurses and therapists. When a patient is admitted to the ICU, we will work hard to get them better. We'll try and get them off the breathing machine. We'll be giving them oxygen, fluids, medications, and nutrition. We can usually save the patient, but not always. And it's a tragedy when someone dies of asthma. When it comes to air pollution, I spend most of my time rescuing patients from the bad effects. But today, I'm here to do something different. Instead of waiting for air pollution to make you sick enough to come to the ICU, I'm here today to help stop air pollution from making you sick at all. I'm here to support the proposed rule that is trying to stop air pollution and making you sick. The proposed rule will remove tons, literally tons, of pollution from the air we breathe. The rule will reduce acid gases and particle matter, both of which are known triggers for asthma. It will remove powerful pollutants such as mercury, lead, dioxins, which can build up the environment and impede or impair a child's growth and brain development. The good news is that we know how to remove the pollution from the air. There are power plants across the United States that have already installed equipment to remove much of the pollution from their smokestacks. Today's proposed rule will require all, yes, all, power plants to install pollution control equipment. This is how we get cleaner and healthier air. As a member of the American Thoracic Society and a physician, I am pleased to support the EPA in its proposed rule to reduce air pollution. The American Thoracic Society will be providing science-based input during the public comment period to ensure the best outcomes for our patients. I look forward to taking a big breath of the healthier and cleaner air and knowing that the health of our families, our patients, our communities will benefit from the EPA's final rule. Thank you.
Even better.
In the past administration, EPA consulted its Children's Health Protection Advisory Committee about clean air act rulemaking on PM, ozone, and lead. Will you be consulting the committee for comments on this rule and also for the carbon monoxide rule, which you issued last month?
Well, you know, the Clean Air Act actually establishes a separate committee, a science advisory committee that we use when we're looking at conventional pollution. It's required by law. Certainly, we can include an outreach to the Children's Public Health Advisory Committee on this rule or any other rules. It's an open public comment period, so we welcome their input as well as any outside science and the public. The Clean Air Act requires that toxic air pollution be addressed in 3 years. So there's a 3-year window of time for compliance, and then it may be extended an extra year once the rule is finalized. So this rule is being proposed now. We'll take public comment. We'll finalize it later this year or early next year, and that begins the timing of those clocks. Obviously, as pointed out in many of the remarks, this is a clock that first started ticking in 1990. Yes?
To what extent do these new standards take into account the different emission profiles of different types of coal?
Different types of?
Coal.
There are subcategorizations in the standards, but there is not a proposed subcategorization based on types of coal. It's a fairly wonky discussion, Stephen, but essentially we believe that technology isn't dependent, the ability to meet standards isn't dependent on the type of coal because technology has advanced so much here in this country for treating toxics. I don't want to ignore. Are all the reporters here? Is that where we're at? Okay.
I'm curious if you have a ballpark for a cost estimate of what it might cost some of these power plants to implement this technology that's being required.
Individual plant numbers, I don't know if we do, because of course it's going to depend on the fleet. Some fleets are different. This rule costs. It's I think the cost on an annualized basis, I believe, is $11 or $12 billion. The benefits are 10 times that much, but that's not to be phased. That's not to be faced by all plants in every year. And the impact on utility bills is quite small, because as we've seen from the way companies make these capital investments, utility industry is a fairly capital intensive industry. They make big investments, and then of course they have rate payers. We estimate impacts on utility bills that are pretty minor, $3 to $4 a month.
So you don't
anticipate I just said $3 to $4 a month. Listen, you know, I can speak from a couple of experiences I know firsthand. Some companies have already gone ahead and met these standards. Almost more than half of the nationwide fleet, and certainly a large number of coal-fired power plants have. I used to work in New Jersey. PSE&G put these controls on their coal-fired fleet. They lowered rates this year. So a lot depends on a lot of other factors, including fuel costs. But when we do our modeling, and it's based on a bunch of assumptions, we see $3 to $4 a month.
I know there's been a lot of industry concern about having to put scrubbers on each and every coal plant. Does the rule enforce that?
The rule is a technology rule. What companies have been doing for a long time is putting off investments. As you heard all the speakers, they haven't made any investments in their fleets. They've waited because they need regulatory certainty. They need to know what the standards will be. Now, that's not to say that someone who runs a large fleet of power plants won't look at some of their really old plants and make determinations about whether or not it makes sense to keep throwing good money after bad. If it's a really old power plant, it may have lots of problems, including metal fatigue and all kinds of issues. They may choose to invest in new generation or other opportunities.
More questions?
All right,
thanks.